Well, good morning, and thank you very much for taking the time, the effort, the energy, the expense to get from wherever you were today to this location in memory of Sue Frizzell. And what a precious lady. Mm-hmm. And had the opportunity to see her, one of the last people to see her that knew her just before she went home to be with the Lord. And I'm very grateful to be able to talk with her, I guess. Other people saw her, but I got to talk with her when she was still conscious. And I'm very honored to have gotten to know her. And what a great group of people here today in her memory. Thank you for coming. We're certainly honored that you came and appreciate so much the opportunity to share these moments with you. We want the Lord Jesus to be honored. And that's someone that she loved very much and had no problem talking about Jesus. We thank the Lord for that. So we want him to be honored. We also want her memory to be blessed. And we rejoice with that. We'll ask the Lord to help us, and then we'll stand together and sing Amazing Grace with Brother Quotso. I think it's no secret, Brother Quotso was one of her favorite people there, and she was a faithful choir member and enjoyed practice and was faithful to practice as she was to sing in the choir. I think that I could say that about her, and I know Brother Quotso could probably echo that. But we thank the Lord for it. Let's pray together, and then he'll come. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for the privilege to be able to remember somebody who definitely, in their life and testimony, remembered you. Thank you for saving her at the age of 18 and giving her the sword of the Lord to give her the assurance of her salvation some years later. I do pray that you would please bless the time we'll spend together in remembering this lovely lady and attempting to allow your Holy Spirit to comfort her loved ones who are here today, but especially her family. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand to our feet, can we please? Let's sing Amazing Grace.
One of Mrs. Frizzell's favorites, Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. When we've been there, when we seated. And in 2009, I believe, the church choir had the blessing and privilege and opportunity to make a recording of several of the favorites of our congregation and of the choir members. And we made a CD recording of that. And I think she was very pleased and proud to be a part of that endeavor. So we'd like to play the title song from that CD, Sing Me a Song About Jesus, and of course, her voice is among those that you hear in this recording, but certainly we know she's enjoying singing even now in heaven.
Sing me a song about Jesus, but we'll sing in that great choir. is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear,
no more sickness, no pain, no more parting over that.
And forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be.
That will be.
When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be.
Thank you all for coming. I want to start out by telling you all my favorite memory of my mom, which is what I believe she loved to do the most, which is read the Bible and pray. One day I came in her room and I said, "Mom, let's read the Bible and pray together." So for the last few months, that's what we did. And the most special time was a week ago Tuesday, and for some reason I chose Psalm 23, which was her favorite psalm. Then We prayed. She would always say, and I would always listen to it when I pray, this was my favorite part. I plead the blood of Jesus for the person or the situation that she was praying for. She loved God and the Lord Jesus Christ and tried to show that every day she walked on this earth. Amen. Now, she loved me and I loved her because every night we were together, I would hug her and give her a kiss and tell each other we loved each other. But the most special moment was last Friday evening when I knew her time was short. And I said, "Mom, I love you." And she said, "I love you too, Kevin. I'll cherish that moment until I die or until Jesus comes again." Now to conclude, I was praying Mom would get well and we were all going to heaven together. That's what I'd always tell her. Mom, we're going to heaven together. But God had a different plan. Thank you again. I want to take this time publicly to thank my mom. I believe she can hear me from heaven right now. Thank you, Mom, for being faithful to God, to reading your Bible, to praying, soul winning, church, choir, Sunday school, and for giving God your life with everything you did. I know you're in the presence of the Lord, and I want to again thank you for your testimony, and I would like to publicly right now rededicate my life to carry on the legacy of a great Christian heritage by being as faithful as my mom was to everything we hold dear as Christians. Thank you.
Yeah, you pray for Kevin, and he got to win somebody to the Lord too yesterday, so that was excellent. So we were all happy for him. I got just a few favorite family memories from her sister Martha. Martha, you want to raise your right hand there? And she nicknamed her the Roadrunner, because she made so many trips to Ohio. Well, he spent a lot of money on the toll road too, to visit her family. She appreciated her visiting so much. Also, she had a contagious laugh. For my sweet wife, Jeanine, her daughter, she always had family devotions all the years I was growing up, even when we started complaining about it. We used to laugh at her and when she put her hair up in curlers and bobby pins. That was a sight. Sundays, we usually had roast beef dinner. When we did our Saturday list of chores, she would play old-time gospel quartet music. For many, many years, she would watch, sit, and sew, making our clothes to save money. She was known for Pepsi, chips, and dip. She would make us eat liver or salmon every week because she said it was healthy. We didn't like it. As a child, I promised myself I would never cook it for my family, and I never did. Thank God. We had a lot of good memories going to the park by our house. She loved Christmas and made it special every year. When I was 10 years old, she let me stay up late and help her decorate the tree and put presents under the tree. I thought that was awesome. I often saw her reading her Bible and praying. She took Brother Hiles literally when he said, "If the church doors are open, be there." She enjoyed keeping preachers for the week during pastor school or hosting WMS meetings in her home. We went to the mother-daughter banquet 40 times. She was so faithful, honest, loving, and forgiving. She loved all of us with her whole heart. How can I repay her for all she's done for me? I can be an answer to her prayers by living for Jesus. I love you, Mom. This one's from me. My mother-in-law and I always get along very well. And that's the truth. I would try to help her out after Dad went to heaven if I could. She even helped me wire the dishwasher when I hooked that up for her. That was dangerous. Not OSHA approved, but we did it. And it still works. She was very easy to make laugh, and I would try to do that on purpose. Really, not hard at all. Usually, she was laughing at herself. Quite a few times I was there for family devotions. Everyone had a Bible and would go around the room reading a verse. One time I was there, it just happened to be the Song of Solomon time. The girls that were there started laughing at the verses they had to read. She got mad and left the room right after we were done. I was surprised to see her storm off like that, but that is how she looked at the Bible, that it was God's word. She liked making birthday time special for you. She would make your favorite meal and cake. Felt funny when she would put a cake and candles in front of you and sing with the lights out. But we did it, and that is what she loved to do. Birthdays are special. From Becky, Mom would let me have a slumber parties with my friends. They loved coming over to our house. She would make brownies for us. She would drive us places like bowling, skating. I enjoyed Mom making coffee, sitting around talking about her past. She would tell stories about her family and friends. From her son Mark, and we're sorry that he couldn't make it. Mom loved the holidays, from hiding Easter baskets, making caramel corn on Halloween, baking pies on Thanksgiving, to making Christmas cookies. We were so lucky. From JR, my son, Grandma loved her grandchildren with all her heart and tried to make us feel special to her by making our favorite meal and dessert for our birthdays, going to Grandma's for delicious home-cooked meals at Christmas, seeing the stockings hung on the door with assorted lifesavers or orange and Wrigley spearmint gum inside, our favorite gift. She had one of the most contagious laughs. You couldn't help but smile or laugh along with her when she was laughing. I'm thankful for her faithfulness to church and choir. When we were younger, we would often tell her we were watching her to make sure she stayed awake during the service. Grandma always let us know she was proud of us, whether it was winning or losing a ball game, completing an assignment, or graduation from college. She would say, "I'm so proud of you." Saying goodbye to Grandma was a must when you left her house or she left yours. I will miss her tight hugs and kisses on the cheek and her I love yous. I'll always be her favorite because I'm the first grandchild, even though I'm the only grandchild she spanked. I love you, Grandma. Love, JR. He deserved it. Granddaughter Connie, my favorite memories with my grandma are being together on our many trips, talking, singing on our drives to Ohio, visit family for her, show me places of her childhood, our trip to California, singing in the car with Frank Sinatra. Also, the thousands of times sitting around the table, eating popcorn, talking, laughing, usually at her. From Jonathan, her grandson. John, would you raise your hand? My favorite memory of Grandma was when Danielle was graduating from high school and Grandma disappeared for an hour. When we found her, we asked her where she went, and she said, "Well, I was looking for a bathroom." From Nick, her grandson Nick, right there. Thank you, Nick. I was 7 or 8 years old, and Grandma took me to the grocery store with her. She drove back to our house, and my mom asked her where I was. Grandma said, "Oh, I forgot him at the store." And my mom told her to go back and get me, which she did, and she kept apologizing. Way to go, Nick. From Danielle, baking Christmas cookies with her every Christmas and hearing her laugh so hard. Her friend Helen McCormick, from the day my husband and I joined the FBC choir in 1986, Sue and I struck up a close friendship in the Elto section. We sat next to each other and enjoyed all the services and pastor schools over the years. We were like little kids, always sharing a secret or a happening. We laughed together and cried together, prayed together about many things. Sue always looked so attractive and well-dressed. Choir practice on Thursday evenings was a great time, relaxed and social. The choir potluck suppers at Brother and Mrs. Hiles' home in the summer was so much fun. Needless to say, I will miss Sue, but praise the Lord for our home in heaven, where we will, without a doubt, be singing in the heavenly choir. From her foster friend, Jane Sunday, Sue was a kind, faithful friend. She wrote many cards and letters to you. Know she was thankful for whatever you did for her. She was a great Christian and she loved her family. She was always talking about them. She was a prayer warrior. She loved Faye Dotson and Phoster Club. She loved soul winning. She loved going to church and raised all her children in church. She will be missed. She was faithful to her duties, even if she was sick. She was so consistent in her Christian testimony over many years, unchanging and steadfast. It was a blessing to be her friend. And the last one is from her Sunday school teacher, Mrs. Jane Grafton. She was one of the sweetest, most thoughtful, caring individuals I have known. She was faithful to send me cards to let me know she was thinking about me and praying for me, or when I had a difficult time. When my mother-in-law went to heaven and my husband had back surgery, or when I was sick, she always encouraged me. The ladies in our Sunday school class said the same thing about her encouraging words on her cards to them. To have Sue in your life was to have a true friend. To have Sue in your life was to be loved, encouraged, and edified. She not only loved people, most of all, she loved God. She never got over the fact that Jesus had saved her and brought her to a church where she could grow spiritually and serve the Christ she loved. She often praised God for things he did for her to demonstrate his love, and those testimonies were often spoken through sweet tears of gratitude. She was a unique woman who had a close walk with God and cared deeply about people. I sure will miss that girl. And you can see that birthday time was always a special time for my mother-in-law. And one thing we do in Junior 5, Brother Wilkerson, is that we sing a happy birthday every week. And we sing it, happy birthday to you. Only one will not do. Born again means salvation. How many have you? And if Grandma was to tell you today, she would say, you need to have two birthdays. And that's what it's all about.
When you're in need of words of comfort, nothing tops the Bible, God's Word, and it's my privilege to read Mrs. Frizzell's favorite psalm, Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Rejoice with each of you who have chosen to come and be a part of this special day for her. In 1934, in a middle-class family, her dad was a hard-working man, her mother was a housewife, and she had four sisters, Doris, Martha, Patty's deceased, and Virginia, deceased. One brother, Tom. She loved her family very, very much, and she loved visiting her grandpa and grandma Dean. The relatives would get together and play instruments and music, and she had such good memories with them. Her immediate family would not go to church, but a neighbor did invite her a few times while growing up, and she loved her high school, the McKinley Bulldogs. At the age of 18, a friend took her to church, and she made a decision to accept Jesus Christ. At the age of 26, while reading the Sword of the Lord and a sermon by Dr. John R. Rice, she made the assurance of her salvation. She met her first husband, Jack Mitchell, while working at the Ohio Power Company, and they had three children, Jeanine, Becky, and Mark. And of course, Mark is at home recovering from an amputation that he had. He may be able to see us today. I have a friend of mine who's going to go see him this afternoon and visit him there in Los Angeles in Lomita area this afternoon. We're praying for him. They attended the Canton Gospel Center in Canton, Ohio. She made many friends there. He was a Christian. Jack was a Christian, but eventually moved to South Chicago and to work here with a job. They moved and lived in Calumet City. In 1963, Martha Nowakowski, the landlady's daughter, invited her to First Baptist Church of Hammond. She had read about Brother Hiles and the Sword of the Lord, but did not know that Hammond and Calumet City were right next to each other in proximity. She attended First Baptist Church, and the first Sunday she visited, she knew the Lord wanted her to raise her three children there. She became involved in WMS, and she loved it, and was still giving to missions prior to her death up to or the Sunday before. She loved missionaries. She joined the choir 2 years later, and she loved singing in the choir. She always looked forward to practices and services. She felt bad when she was sick or out of town. She also taught in the junior one department, or normally the third and fourth grade class. She taught for many years in the seventh grade as a substitute teacher, and eventually was a part of the Phoster Club. How many ladies knew her through Phoster Club? Would you raise your hand, ladies? God bless you. Thank you for being here in support of her today. She was always going over and over her soul winning plan so she could be able to share the gospel with people. She was faithful to give out gospel tracts and even put them in her bills and gave them to salesmen when they came door to door. She had a burden for our friends and her family members to come to know the Lord. She prayed hard and through the years that friends and relatives would be saved. She was so happy. She was very sad about her divorce. But she just kept on going and stayed faithful to the Lord. She counseled Brother Hiles, and he told her to stay here and keep raising those children for the Lord instead of going back to Ohio. She said that she first, she said when she first had children, she followed Dr. Spock's book on child rearing. But then she read in the Bible, the Sword of the Lord, and heard Brother Hiles preaching, and she wanted to discipline her children. The three oldest children can testify of that. When she got older, she kind of felt bad for being so strict. A couple of years later, she remarried Ken Frizzell. And she met him at the church, and eventually, the Lord gave them Kevin, which you've heard him give his testimony today. Brother Hiles and Ken and said that Ken and Sue were like Abraham and Sarah, that when God gave them Kevin. She kept faithful to church. She loved reading her Bible and praying, which you heard that several times in testimonies. She also loved to read. She especially liked Christian biographies, and she is famous for being a great cook, especially spaghetti, lasagna, tacos, and she probably made a million cinnamon rolls. She made her birthdays always special and always with a favorite cake and meal, and she was so happy when First Baptist Church started the Hammond Baptist Schools. She prayed hard to make sure that we could attend, and we all did. She was so happy and proud of us. Her prayer and dream was for all of us to be saved, follow the Lord in baptism, and to stay faithful to the Lord to serve Him. She was a secretary for several law firms, downtown Chicago, and trademark company for 20 years. And she would take the train every day to work. She loved Chicago and enjoyed working there. She retired to help take care of Ken, who was sick and eventually bedridden. He died in 2004, and she made many dear friends from the church, and so many were sad. She was sad when many of them went to heaven before she did. She always thought she would go up in the rapture, but the Lord had other plans. As time went by, her daughters married and had children. She loved being a grandmother to J.R., Connie, Jonathan, Nicholas, Nick, and Danielle. They're all of her favorites. She loved them very much and was very proud of them. When she became a great-grandparent, she loved calling them, they loved calling her Gigi for great-grandmother. Every time they came to see her, she smiled and her eyes lit up, and she loved Matthew and Todd, Aubrie, Ashley, Aviella, and Alana. Aviella was born on her birthday, and she was not without heartaches in her life. Sue was not, but she stayed faithful through trials. She could be stubborn, and that was for sure, but she was so faithful to the Lord. She was honest, hardworking, and a friend. She loved the Lord and her family. She always made us laugh. Not trying to be funny, we tried hard not to laugh at her and just laugh with her. She will be missed, not only by her family, but by many friends who knew her. What a beautiful tribute to a mom. And Jeanine, thank you for helping us with that. And, of course, Jeanine knew her longest, except for maybe siblings today. And we certainly thank you for those thoughts. Well, if you can have pictures, beautiful pictures and Bibles and things of that nature, soul winning New Testament, things that are over here. And then, of course, the beautiful worn Bible that's in her casket today. But when I looked at her Bible for Kevin today, and she'll circle a verse and say, I prayed this for Kevin, or I prayed this for Rick and Jeannie, or for Becky. She put little notes beside verses that meant something to her, for her grandchildren. I thought that was very beautiful about a Bible. But in Psalm 119, there's a couple verses that obviously seem to me to be very dear to her. And here's what they say. Teach me, O Lord, in the way of thy statutes, and I shall keep them unto the end. Give me understanding, and I shall keep thy law. Yea, I shall observe it with my whole heart. Make me to go in the path of thy commandments, for therein do I delight. Each of those verses start out with teach me, give me, make me. It's a beautiful testimony to this lady who got saved at the age of 18 and read, and at the age of 26 made sure of it on her own by reading the sword of the Lord. But there are several things when I think about this lovely, lovely person. And I got a text, and I knew she wasn't feeling good. Sunday before last, she had to exit the service a little early and went out and got sick in the parking lot and made her way home, and Kevin took her home, and she kind of gathered herself, went to a little gathering with the family, and then went back, and she hated to miss church, but she wasn't feeling good, and she stayed home. And then through the week, I checked on a couple times and found out she was sick, and they finally took her to the hospital. Text Kevin, and Kevin had let me know that, boy, Mom is pretty sick. And I was coming home with Coleman, and he was playing a baseball game, and he finished, and he rode home with me, and we were going to Indianapolis Boulevard, and I thought, oh, no, I want to go see Miss Sue. Can you go with me? He said, yeah, we went, and went over there and couldn't get in the regular entrance. Had to go around the back way and made her way to her room. They were moving her from room number 9 to room number 5 in the ICU ward there. And two sweet nurses, Mary and Debbie, were taking care of her and moving her that way. I waited about 20, 25 minutes just waiting for them to finish. They said, if you'll give us a second, Pastor will be there. And that kind of went a little longer than I thought, but we stood there, and Coleman and I talked about her and her family. And then they came out and said, I think you can see her now. And I went in to see her, and she, of course, had her hospital gown on, and she was covered up and had the blanket on her, and the lady was over there working on some of her vital signs and things of that nature. And I walked in. I said, I'm Miss Sue. And she said, hi, Pastor. I said, you're kind of sick, huh? She goes, oh, Pastor, I am so sick. I just feel terrible. And they had told me that she had a UTI infection, of course, and that can affect you in many ways and make you pretty miserable. I told her they were going to treat her with IVs, and she'll probably be on the mend soon. She said, oh, I sure hope so. But I left about 9:25 that night, maybe 9:30. Walked, prayed with her, held her hand and prayed with her, and then made her way to the car. And then in the middle of the night, Rick and Jeanie got the call that her blood pressure had dropped, and she went unconscious, and that was the last moments of consciousness we knew she had before she entered in the presence of the Lord. When I thought about her throughout this week, several things came to my mind, especially after seeing her Bible and seeing that verse that she liked, those verses that she liked so much. First of all, I find there's three things that I would just say if I could give an acrostic of Sue's name. I would say, number one, she was a steadfast servant. She's steadfast. Set your clock. Sue Frizzell is going to be there. And faithful. And that's a dying breed, unfortunately. I don't think completely dying breed. There's young people that have steadfastness, but so many people just, it's just, if they come, they come. If they do, they don't. If no one's there, somebody will be there for them. But that was not the way Sue was made. She was a steadfast servant. And she said, teach me, O Lord, the way of thy statutes. Teach me the way I should do, and I shall keep them unto the end. If I could just say this about Sue Frizzell, she finished the finish line standing up and the proverbially chest out, crossing with strides. She didn't crawl. She finished strong. And I think that's a great testimony. Whether you're 4, 40, or 80, I hope that you will endeavor to do the same thing. That you'll keep the statutes and the way of the Lord unto the end. Don't waver. Don't be wayward. Be faithful. What a great testimony. She was a steadfast servant. She was a unique personality. I think we've heard today, and our kids have told us that, and those who know us, she's just a very unique personality, very special. Things that maybe would have been Funny, I remember one time going with my daughter Lydia and Lacey. We made a visit up at Munster Med Inn when she was there for a while, healing up from a difficulty she was having. And we sang together, but I remember her hair being in rollers, you know, and things of that nature. And it didn't seem to bother her. It wasn't like, you know, oh, you caught me with my hair in rollers. She just like, is take me as I am. Like it or lump it, this is what I do on a Saturday. But I thought myself, I just we sang together with her and just enjoyed the visit together with her. But I thought, what a sweet, sweet and unique personality. Somebody who just, and she didn't really give a rip what everyone else thought. Didn't care, soul winning. That's why I think she was a great soul winner. She was willing to pray and she'd love and continue. And part of the personality that God gave her. And then she had an enduring commitment. And just a continual commitment. I admire that in not only her, but her offspring as well. I think it's a great testimony. Here's what it says here. Make me to go in the paths of thy commandments, for therein do I delight. I don't think Sue Frizzell went to church because she had to. She went to church because she got to. I don't think she read her Bible because, well, I'm supposed to read my Bible today. She did it because she could and because it was her delight. I think giving was a delight. I think serving WMS, that was a delight. What a sad thing that many people are going to stumble into the presence of God having done what they could because they had to, not because they got to. And here it says, thy law, thy words, they are my delight. Therein do I delight. There's one other verse that it's in her Bible. There's a star beside it, but it's Psalm 119, 135. And I like this verse too, and I think she did as well. Here's what it says. Make thy face to shine upon thy servant and teach me thy statutes. I would just say that I believe that God allowed the years of life that she had to her face, God's glory shined upon his servant. And I appreciate that so much about her. I want to not to assume that everyone here knows for sure that if you died, you'd go to heaven. I believe that Rick said that just a minute ago. Kevin had the joy to across the fence lead a young man to the Lord yesterday and thought about that because of his love for his mother and his mother's love for souls. He was thankful that God gave him that. But Rick said if Sue could be here now, she would say, make sure, birthdays are so important, make sure you have two of them. I was sitting on a plane yesterday with an engineer from Wheaton, Illinois, and we began talking about a second birthday. And I said, you know, when is your second birthday? So, I kind of evolved into this thing. And I said, no, you don't evolve into salvation. Maybe there's things God leads up to that. And I said, there needs to be a moment of time. He goes, oh, okay, now hang on a second. I know when that happened. He told me, you know, somebody said, I'm concerned about my wife. I don't know that she has one of those times. But, you know, Sue had a time like that. Do you have a time like that? Do you know for sure when life's over that you go to heaven? Do you have questions about that? Maybe you say, I don't remember when I did that. Maybe it's because you weren't there. You don't remember because you weren't. You have not been born again. And on a day when we can really look, and I think the greatest testimony of Sue's life to me is for the child of God to be able to see somebody who most everyone who knew her after she was saved. And we saw Jesus in her and faithfulness and commitment and enduring strength and steadfastness. But there may be someone here today and you're not sure if you were to die, you'd go to heaven. If that's the case, let's don't go to hell from this memorial service. Don't go to hell having Sue Frizzell as your friend. You can have eternal life, but you have to be born again. Do you know for sure when life's over, you go to heaven? If you don't know that, there are four sweet things you need to understand. The first of two are not too sweet. Number one, we're sinners. We can't go to heaven that way. You've got to admit that. If that's not easy for you to admit, you'll need to get over that barrier before you can be saved. We have to realize that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. It doesn't matter how good we are, we can't earn eternal life ourselves. The secret of eternal life is to learn that it cannot be earned. we're sinners. Number two, the price of sin is separation from God in the lake of fire. Jesus calls it the second death. He said, and whosoever was not written in the book of life, the book of the new birth, was cast in the lake of fire. This is the second death. So if we're going to be saved, we'll have to, number one, admit we're a sinner. We can't go to heaven that way. Number two, we'll have to recognize that if I had to pay for my own sin, I would be separated from a God who loved me and didn't want it that way. But then we have to understand, number three, that Jesus paid for our sin on the cross. Jesus did all that was needed to be done so that sinners like me, sinners like you, sinners like Sue could have eternal life. And he offers us a gift. See, most people are confused and they think that salvation is a reward for being righteous, when really the Bible teaches very clear it's a gift for being guilty. It's a gift. And a gift has to be free and it has to be accepted. Everyone, just because Jesus died and he paid for the gift of eternal life does not mean everyone's going to heaven. There needs to be a time and a place when people personally accept that gift of eternal life. Then we must believe and receive Christ. To have eternal life, we must believe in our heart and accept him as our Savior. It's not hard to do. Salvation, God does all the work. Here's our two options, and listen to this very carefully. When you go into eternity, you either go in eternity with a fair trial or a free pardon. All of your sin will be open, and you can have a fair trial with a judge who knows everything about you and is absolutely holy, and we're not. And you can take your chances with a free trial before God, or you can accept the free pardon from Jesus Christ. Have you done that? Have you accepted God's gift of eternal life? If you haven't, let me encourage you, do that today. I'll be glad to talk with you. I can even lead you in a prayer in a moment. But if you do pray that prayer after believing your heart, I would want you to let someone know that you did that. But at least let someone give you a gospel tract. They're available on the back table. I have some with me. Or come talk to me or someone around you and say, you know how to be saved. Many people would be more than glad to explain to you the gospel of Christ. For those of us who are saved today, may we take and think of a life of Sue Frizzell as a life well lived for the Lord Jesus Christ, with a steadfast servant and enduring commitment. May those of us who are here that may not know for sure we have eternal life, don't leave this room without Jesus and having eternal life. It's not hard. God did all the work. But you and I must accept that gift. And it's the best day in someone's life when they do that. Let's pray together. With their heads bowed and eyes closed, there may be someone who would say right now, Pastor, I understand I'm a sinner. I understand I deserve the lake of fire. And I understand that Jesus is my only way that I can have eternal life. And I would like to accept Christ right now. I realize that most people, that's not their story, but it may be yours. Maybe you would say, Pastor, I don't know when I accepted Christ, and I didn't. And I need to do that and get that settled. If so, in your heart, can you say, I know I'm a sinner. I know I deserve hell. Jesus is my only hope. And I'm willing to accept his gift of eternal life and ask him to save me. If you believe this in your heart, would you say this with your mouth to God? Dear Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I know I deserve the lake of fire. But I believe that Jesus died. He was buried and he rose again so I could be saved. Come into my life, forgive my sin, and save me. If you sincerely believed in your heart and you accepted the Lord as your Savior, the Bible says, whosoever believeth in him should not be ashamed. And whosoever called on the Lord shall be saved. If someone truly accepts Christ, they're saved, and they should not be embarrassed about it. And if that's the case, I hope you'll let someone know. You'll tell them, I accepted Christ as my Savior. If you need more answers or you have more questions, please let someone help you with that. Our Father in heaven, I thank you for the privilege to be a part of a special day with sweet friends of Sue Frizzell. Thank you for her beautiful family that have chosen to come, some from Ohio and others from this local area. I pray for Mark, Lord, as he views this from California, recovering from some challenging times. I pray you bless our dear brother, help him. I know he deeply loved his mom. Father, I pray that you would please now help us as we conclude the service. Thank you so much for your goodness, your kindness to us. I pray that, Lord, that you would please continue to bring comfort and challenge to each of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, Brother John Matthewson, what a wonderful servant of God and a great singer, has been asked to sing. If you could see me now, we'll look forward to hearing that. And then you'll direct your attention to the screens. There are some pictorial memories that are available for you. And then we'll conclude in just a moment.
Our prayers have all been answered. I finally arrived. The healing that had been delayed has now been realized. No one's in a hurry. There's no schedule to keep. We're just all enjoying Jesus, just sitting at his feet. If you could see me now, I'm walking streets of gold. If you could see me now, I'm standing tall and whole. If you could see me now, you'd know I've seen his face. If you could see me now, you know my pain's erased. You wouldn't want me to ever leave this place. If only you could see me now. My light and temporary trials have worked out for my good. To know it brought him glory when I misunderstood. Though we've had our sorrows, they can never compare to what Jesus has in store for us. No language can share. If you could see me now, I'm walking those streets of gold. You could see me now, I'm standing tall and whole. If you could see me now, you'd know I've seen his face. If you could see me now, you know this pain's erased. Streets of gold. If you could see me now, I'm standing tall and whole. If you could see me now, you'd know I've seen Jesus' face. If you could see me now, you know my pain's erased. You wouldn't want me to ever leave this perfect place. If you could only see me now. If you could see me now. If you could see me now.
Thank you. into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Thank you for coming, each of you. He'll come in just a moment. The family is asked a little different to dismissal today. We'll not have a final repass. Just whenever he directs us, we'll leave the family here just for a few moments. They'll close the casket, make their way to the graveside. And so if you'll keep that in mind, we'll not have a normal repass. We'll just be able to dismiss. So if you'll please vacate the facility as directed as soon as possible, that would help us get to the graveside a little bit more rapid.
On behalf of the entire Frizzell family, we would like to thank each of you for attending today's service. Thank you for the outpouring of love and support that you've shown the family during this very difficult time. And just a reminder that in the coming days, weeks, and months ahead, each of them will continue to need that same love and support. We'd like to thank each one who had a part in today's service. Thank you for those of you who shared your memories, your fond memories of Mrs. Frizzell. Thank you for the wonderful special music. And we'd especially like to thank our pastor for his words of comfort. At this time, we will be dismissing you. We want you to just go ahead and go out into the foyer or maybe outside. If you are going to go out to the graveside, you are welcome to go, as Pastor mentioned. But we do want to give the family their own private time at this time before we close the casket. Once again, thank you for attending today's service. Mm-hmm.